Linguistics compromises all manifestations of the human speech regardless of time or place. Sacher defines linguistics as the study of language and as the study of the manifestations of the human speech. He says that linguistics is also concerned with the history of languages and with the social or cultural influences that shape the development of the language. Ferdinand D. Sacher is a Swiss linguistic and semiotician. He is known as the father of semiology. He is the founding figure of the modern linguistics. He is an important structuralist. His work Cours in General Linguistics were lectures which he delivered to his students in Geneva. They were reconstructed from students' notes. This Cours of General Linguistics forms the basis of modern linguistics. In Cours in General Linguistics, Sacher explains the relationship between language and speech. In his work, Sacher made primary distinctions of lang and parole, signifier and signified. According to him, lang refers to language as a structured system grounded on certain rules. The parole is a specific act of speech or utterance which are based on those rules. Among lang and parole, Sacher gave more importance to lang as it is a universal unlike parole, which is a willful individual act. When language and speaking are separated, it is also separated from what is social, from what is individual, because language is social. It has certain standardized rules and conventions while speaking in an individual act. He then gives us various examples to understand better. He also gives us the characteristics of language. They are, language is a well-defined object in the heterogeneous mass of speech facts. Sacher establishes that language is based on auditory image with a concept, but that does not mean one can modify language as they like. Though there are possibilities of multiple utterances, language remains homogeneous with a well-defined structure. Language can be studied separately, unlike speaking. This also means that even dead languages can be learned. Speech is heterogeneous, whereas language is homogeneous with well-defined structure. It is a system of sign that both parts of sign, sound image and concept are psychological. Language is concrete. According to Sacher, language is a system of sign that expresses ideas. The study of signs is called semiology. To him, semiology is a science that studies the language of sign within a society. Sign, signifier and signified. According to Sacher, sign consists of both signifier and signified. Sign is the smallest unit of meaning which helps to communicate. Signifier refers to a particular object that gives meaning. It is a physical thing. Signified is a mental concept which is evolved in our mind. It is associated with psychological concepts. He perceives the linguistic unit as a double entity. Signifier and signified are the two components of sign. He then says that the linguistic sign unites not a thing and a name, but a concept and sound image. The link between the sound image and concept is arbitrary. The two elements, sound image and concept, are intimately united. They are inseparable. They are not two different entities, but they are looked at in different ways. This he explains using the Latin word arbor, tree. The sound image is not the physical sound, but the silent imprint of it. That is how we can read aloud, silently, or even speak to ourselves. There is no precedence or sequence in the recall of the sound image or concept. We do not first mentally picture a tree and then link it to its concept or vice versa. But the sound image and concept have to be united and are thus recalled together. He says, it is not the term itself, it is a mental impression. Sacher said, if the words sound image and concept were given names, ambiguity would disappear. So he called sound image signifier and concept signified. The linguistic sign has two primordial characteristics. The basic principle of any study of this type are arbitrary nature of the sign and linear nature of the signifier. Principle 1. Arbitrary nature of the sign. As discussed before, The signifier and the signified are arbitrarily based, and the sign which is the product of these two parts is also arbitrary. Sound images or signifiers do not give an idea of the sign. The sounds TREE do not resemble a tree in any case. Also, the term arbitrary, when used in reference to a signifier, indicates that it has no natural connection with the signified. The idea of sister is not linked to the sound of the word sister. The link between the idea and the sound, or the signified and the signifier, is a matter of societal convention. The German word Schwester and Spanish word Hermana each refers to the idea of sister, but the sound of the respective signifier are nothing alike. Sascha concludes this principle by considering the two objections for establishing the principle. They are onomatopoeia and interjunctions. Onomatopoeic formations are limited in number and they vary in their representation across languages. To an English speaker, a dog barking may sound like bow mau. French speakers may hear it wow wow. Instead, while Gujarati speakers might understand it to be bow bow. Thus, onomatopoeia is not natural, it is a product of culture. Like onomatopoeia, interjections too are a product of culture, as if a French cook spills the butter, she might say hail, while an English one will say ouch. Also, many interjunctions were words which had their own specific meanings. Principle 2. Linear nature of the signifier. The signifier is of linear nature because auditory signifiers have at their own command only the dimension of time. It represents a span, and the span is measurable in a single dimension, that of time. The signifier is auditory, and so the changes that occur are best studied through time. The characteristics of the signifier are that represents a span. The span can be measured only through a line. To study a signifier diachronically would be through the axis of simultaneities, AB, which would be more evolutionary study, for it would deal with changes over a period of time. A synchronic study, the axis of succession, CD, would concern study a particular part of a whole at a given point of time. Static or synchronic linguistic studies are based on the study of language at a particular point in time, whereas the evolutionary or diachronic mode studies historical and evolutionary within language. By nature, linguistic signs are linear as they represent a span in one dimension. Auditory signifiers are linear as they form a chain, and so can also be termed as a speech chain. In linguistics, it is the same relationship between the old facts and the language state which is a projection at any particular moment when we compare the both at a point. In this, we don't learn synchronic projections but diachronic events, even geometric projections which may be correspondence between the points of a figure and a surface. All comparisons may be imagined in any manner. The imaginary thinking is drawn between the functioning of language and a game of chess. In this, we compare the random system of values that is set according to its rules and their modifications. When they are placed by others in a game of chess, it is not real of what language gives, it is natural way. It may differ from person to person, but the set of language rules remains the same. To examine in detail, let us consider a set of chessmen who are very closely related to a set of languages. Each value of pieces depends on a particular position they are on the chessboard. Its values adds on decreases, just like each linguistic term gets more value added to it from the opposition party or term. The system is always very short, so it is varying from one position to the next value. Once the values are applied to a particular game, it is finalized one. It was fixed once upon a time. Same it suits in a language. They are constant in the study of signs, especially always or semiotics. We have a counterpart of the diachronic phenomenon with all its peculiarity. In fact, in a play, only one chess piece is moved. Likewise, the same rule is applied in language. Changes are set apart in elements. The move is opposite in spite of another action on the old set. The impossibilities for the player who is playing is to see what move is the last. In chessboard, each move is very particular from coming before something in order. Position the change gets effects only to both states, but only one state which the player is in matters. Any particular position we are at in the chess, the most important unique element is released then from the existed before or preceding another. The route they may have used makes no sense. Throughout the whole match has no advantage over it, but only the one who knows something is at very serious moment to know the state of the game where he is. This is all suiting the language and shows the distinctions between dichrony and synchrony. Speaking depicts only languages, but the changes it may differ in the middle at different levels of a place of elements they have placed at. Linguistic value from a conceptual viewpoint. A word value is its own property of standing of an idea, but value differs from significations. Language is a system of interpreted terms in which the value of each system results solely from the simultaneous presence of the others. Outside the lang, all values are apparently governed by the same paradoxical principle. A dissimilar thing can be exchanged for the thing which the value is to be determined, and similar things that can be compared with the things of which the value is to be determined. A word can be exchanged for a dissimilar thing, an idea, while also being compared to something of a similar nature, a word. Value is not fixed so long as one simply states that it can be exchanged for a given concept. Its content is really only fixed by the concurrence of everything that exists outside of it. It is endowed not only with the significations but also and especially with a value, and this is something quite different. Linguistics value from a material viewpoint. Value from a conceptual and material view is based on its relations and differences with other terms or language. Every language forms its words on the basis of a system of sonorous elements, each element being a clearly delimited unit and one of the number or fixed one. Phonics are characterized not by their own positive quality, but by the fact that they are distinct. It is differences that carry significance, so a word is not just a sound, but the phonic differences that make it up. Language has to be based on its non-coincidence with the arbitrary and differential as correlative quantities. The alternation of linguistic signs is the best example. A by B have sufficient differences to make an impression on the consciousness. A linguistic signifier isn't merely phonic, but though incorporeal as a material substance by the differences that separates mat from cat. The signs used in writing are arbitrary, as well as there is no connection between the sounds and symbols of the designations. The value of letters is negative and differential, and letters can be written in any form so as long as they can be differentiated from each other. Besides, the value functions only in the particular fixed system, as a Chinese alphabet in English would have no meaning as there is no opposition with the other letters. The forms depend on the opposition and limits of a given system. The means if a sign projection does not matter. In language, there are only differences. A difference generally implies positive terms between which the difference is set up. But in language, there are only differences without positive terms. Language has neither ideas nor sounds that existed before the linguistic system, but only conceptual and phonic differences that have issued from the system. A linguistic system is a series of differences of sound combined with a series of differences of ideas, but the pairing of a certain number of acoustical signs that as many cuts made from the mass of thoughts engendered a system of values, and this system serves as the effective link between the phonic and psychological elements within each sign. Maintaining the parallelism between the two classes of differences is the distinctive function of the linguistic institution. From these concepts, we conclude that the alternation of a word occasions a conceptual change and it is obvious that the sum of the ideas distinguished corresponds in principle to the sum of the distinctive signs. When two words are confused through phonetic alternation, the ideas that they express will also tend to become confused if only they have something in common. Comparing signs towards one another, we no longer speak of differences. The expression would not be fitting, for it applies only to comparing two sound images. Difference makes character just as it makes value and the unit. Thus, Shasher shows that the meaning or significance of sign is established by the relation to each other. The relation of sign to each other forms the structure of language. Synchronic reality is found in the structure of language at a given point of time. Diachronic reality is found in changes of language over a period of time. Shasher views language as having an inner duality which is manifested by the interaction of synchronic and diachronic, the syntagmatic and associative, the signifier and signified.